Welcome to the Q podcast.
Q is about conversation.
If we're really concerned about ending poverty, we've got to be more concerned about creating justice.
Our cultural products as Christians need to both defy and resonate with the culture.
And God's doing amazing things. His church is expanding, his church is growing.
It's not what's the purpose of my life, it's what is the purpose that's been assigned.
Stay curious, think well, advance good. This is Q.
Welcome to another edition of Q Ideas Podcast. I'm Gabe Lyons and excited about the conversation you're going to get to hear today. I'm excited about what you're going to hear today because it's the energy and the enthusiasm of this next generation that has me so encouraged. And I think you're going to be encouraged as well when you hear Rashawn Copeland deliver his 9-minute talk. At the Culture Summit this year, he shared with us why he does what he does. Now, many of you, I don't know that you've heard of Rashawn Copeland, but those of you who are on TikTok, those of you who follow along maybe on YouTube and social media, you may be aware of Rashawn Copeland because over the last couple of years, he's been someone who has essentially created a following around asking people in random situations this question: Jesus is king? Yes or no? Now, I know that may not make sense, and you might be wondering, well, how does that work? What are you talking about? Well, what I'm talking about is in the middle of Walmart or Target or in a parking lot, just talking to random strangers and asking them this question on camera, and they quickly respond yes or no. It's amazing how many people respond yes. They believe Jesus is king. And the reason we wanted Rashawn to talk is because there's a simplicity and a boldness and a courage to the ways in which he is spreading good news and engaging people to have to think for a moment, where's my allegiance? Who is my king? Do I really believe this? Would I say it on camera? All these questions that must come up in someone's mind when posed with that question. Well, Rashawn Copeland, he's the founder of an organization called I'm So Blessed Media. He's the author of 2 books, Start Where You Are and No Turning Back. And he's also received over 30 million likes on these videos. So not only are they entertaining and engaging, but it's fun to see how many people start to like these videos. And they like to see somebody with a big smile, which if you could see this talk, those of you who are on Q Media, I want you to go watch it to see Rashawn's smile. I mean, a beautiful smile, so engaging, but also winsome and full of joy. You're going to hear that as you get challenged to think about how are you declaring the gospel in your world. Let's listen in now to Rashawn Copeland's talk, The Power of Declaration.
Now, y'all know I got to ask y'all, is Jesus king? Yes or no? Jesus es rey. That's in Spanish for y'all who didn't know. But man, I'm just so elated to be here today. Extremely honored and humbled to be here today. I was just thinking about my Uber driver when I got off the plane, and you know, I was a bit tired. I got 4 boys under 4, so I was real tired. Like whenever I got in the Uber, I'm sitting in there, and this man, he's already listening to this song. I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about this somebody who saved my soul, and I can't sing. But I was excited about that because, like, he's in there singing it. And, like, unbeknown to me, it looked like a God wink to me because I'm over here about to share about the power of declaration or declaring God, declaring Jesus, and this man's over here ministering to me. I mean, and then I got super excited. I'm talking Red Bull excited. I got really excited. So needless to say, there's so many ways we can proclaim the name of God, speak God's truth and love to a culture that's dying and that needs it most, right? But I wanna share with you not how I knew or come to knowing what declaring the name of God to be. No pastor taught me it. Like no one even shared with me about Jesus up until I got shot, went to a hospital, and a nurse shared with me about Jesus. But it was in the most darkest moment of my life, a young lady from Baylor University reached out to me in my darkest hour. I mean, I'm at the lowest point. I was a hype man for a guy in the industry at that time. And I remember sitting in my house, just going through a bout of depression, so much pain. I put a pistol in my mouth And I'm on my knees and I'm shaking and I'm sweating. I take this pistol back out of my mouth. I pick it back up. I'm shaking and I'm sweating. My heart's beating out of my chest. My mind's racing. And I'm thinking of two things. The first thing, if I were to shoot myself and I were to die, I've heard of this God, this omnipotent, omniscient, all-knowing, all-seeing God who's infinite in wisdom and knowledge and understanding. And he's loving, but he's also holy. I heard about him. And then the second thing I thought of when I had the pistol in my mouth is if I were to shoot myself and I were to live, I would have to go through the same agonizing pain that I went through as a 17-year-old boy when I was shot down, left for dead. And I don't know anybody who wants to get shot again. It's the worst pain ever, like literally. Anybody been shot in here? Okay. It was the craziest thing ever. And the most painful thing I ever had to endure. But by the grace of God, this young lady in this dark room, God uses her to send a message that lights up the room in my darkest hour. I take the gun, I set it on the bed, and I pick up the phone. And all of a sudden, I'm reading these powerful, profound words that literally penetrated the deepest parts of my soul. But it said this: oh, how wide, how deep, how vast the love of God is. And nothing in all creation can separate us from this love that's found in Christ Jesus. And when I started reading and reading, I started weeping and weeping. And that was the first time I seen myself reading it over 20 times, and my heart would melt every time, but I began to speak and declare without even knowing. I wasn't even a Christian at that time, but I began to speak the word of God over me. And I just remember in that moment, when you began to get a revelation of who God is and what Jesus has done and his love for you, like, it changed me. And I remember going to sleep that night, and I fell asleep, and I woke up about 4 a.m, and I didn't go from this perfect moment, all joy, you know, I didn't go from this dark moment to all joy. I was wrestling with God like Jacob that night, and I fell asleep. I woke back up at 4 a.m, and I literally, the Lord began speaking to me. He said, go turn on the light. I went and turned on the light. I was just obedient to a little simple thing like that. Went back to the bed. And then I really felt compelled out of nowhere, really weird, but felt compelled to go underneath the bed and pull out this suitcase that I had never seen before. So I pull out this suitcase and I open it up, and there's these dirty clothes. But on top, there's this priceless treasure. It was a book. Guess what book it was? The B-I-B-L-E. Yes, that's the book for me. I stand upon the word of God. Yes, the B-I-B-L-E. Guys, when I opened it up and I read it, it started to read me. I went to the red letters. That was the only thing that stuck out that night, y'all. That was the only thing that stuck out on those pages. And I went over to the red letters and I began to read it. And it was the words of Jesus. And I didn't know it was the words of Jesus when I read it, but it said this: if any man wants to be my disciple, he must deny himself, pick up his cross, and follow me. And then he says, he that wants to keep his life must lose it. But he that loses his life for my name's sake shall gain it. And then it said these words, and I was dazzled. I seen the glory of God, and it dazzled me. Oh, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world, but yet lose his soul? I'm done, God. So I packed up everything I could. I got my bag. The Bible's the number one stolen book in the world, y'all. Y'all know that statistically? I stole that book that night. So I end up, I just got his word, and I packed my bag. I left the G-Wagon, left the house in the valley, and I just left. I came across a bus stop, and I literally just sat at this bus stop, and I'm sitting here and I'm just reading things like, many are the plans of a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. And I'm like, okay, I got it. I had many plans in my life, God. I had many plans, but it's your purpose. Got it. And then I got on the bus. I start riding around on the bus for hours and hours, disconnected from the world, connected to the word of God, y'all. And he began to transform me and change me moment by moment in that just this empty bus. Jesus didn't meet me in Galilee. He met me on a bus. And I'm sitting here riding for hours. I finally get downtown to the Greyhound station. And I began to share Jesus the best I knew how. It was really weird. But what I've been observing, even in the Bible, when I read right here in 1 Thessalonians 1 verse 5, for our gospel did not come to you in word only. I love that. But also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance. I love that so much, guys. Check this out. As you know, what kind of men we were among for your sake. And then Paul, if we go down to the second chapter, he says this, but as we have been approved by God to be entrusted to the gospel, even so we speak, not as pleasing to men, but to God who tests our hearts. For neither at any time did we use flattering words, as you know, nor cloak our covetousness. God is our witness. But what I really pull from this is that, you know, this isn't no false hope. This isn't a motivational speech, nor is it, you know, something that is made up. This is something we must be convinced of. Like when we want to go out and declare the gospel, we have to be convinced these are the very words of God. Right? And when we have that conviction, our lives will begin to change. And what is changing our life, we can't help but to champion that message, which changed us, right? We can stand for many causes, and many causes are going to fade and fail, but this will prevail. This will prevail, right? The grass withers, the flowers fade, but it's the word that shall stand forever. And I think I'm getting down to my last seconds. I want to just challenge you with this last little thing I wrote up. I want to challenge you guys with this little thing. So many of us are championing a cause to change the world, but we won't champion the message of the one who called and changed us. I want to just encourage you to go out, whoever you cross or whoever you may know or may not know, strangers, loved ones, go share with them the gospel of Jesus Christ that changed your life so we can go see the nations hear and know about the King Jesus. Amen. Awesome. Love y'all.
Well, I hope you enjoyed hearing Rashawn, but I think understanding the story, where Rashawn came from, just the depth of gratitude he has to his Lord, to his King, helps you better understand why he would be so persuasive as well as so bold as to declare this over and over again all the time and want people to know that Jesus is King. Because when your life's saved, then you really have found something that you want to tell everyone about. And shouldn't we all be doing that? Shouldn't we all be feeling that way, thinking that way, talking that way? I hope today you're encouraged by this talk, and I would encourage you to share it with those who are in your life. Maybe it's one of your kids. Maybe it's a college student, somebody in the next generation who's following along on social media. Tell them to go follow Rashawn Copeland and to be a part of watching how people respond when we declare Jesus is King. Well, I hope this has made you smile today, and I hope you have a great week.